Today we're going to take a magical mystery tour into the wonderful magical world of the Beatles. And this will probably be a more than one part session.
Probably. They're big.
Much to cover. And actually the most important of this will be the introduction, okay? It's going to be the basis for future logic. So I looked at the array of Beatles songs that you sent me in their chronological order, and it was good because I could look at a song and go, oh yeah, they do that there. And I've often said to you, you could find an example of just about, well, many, many examples of music theory situations that are the Beatles actually covered. So the Beatles, like, really can be taught as a music theory course. All right, but the first thing I want to start with is we're going to go way back for a minute to get some basis. All right, one thing I've noticed is that in the postmodern era, when it comes to the arts, it seems to be that you had tradition, which was basically a sense of order.
Okay.
So like when you go into the classical music field, from Baroque to classical, it wasn't such a huge radical change. I mean, it was a change, but it wasn't incredibly radical because they were still using a theory that worked. And the same thing for Romantic. But when you get to the edge of Romantic music, what happened was, okay, we've done all this stuff. We need more stuff. We're losing interest in just the basic set of rules that we were given.
When was that? When did that start going downhill?
Yeah, that started happening like in the late 1800s.
Oh, really? That? Okay.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah. No. So like Romantic music reached its climax around the late 1800s, and it began to pass over into what was called Impressionism. And the Impressionists weren't so terribly radical either, but they did employ new concepts. For example, they were listening to jazz, and jazz makes these big, fat, extended chords, so the classical guys liked the idea of doing that, and they did these chords, what it called, they moved them in parallel, which means there's no really rhyme or reason for the movement except the alternate sound. So, like, for example, in Pavane for a Dead Princess by Ravel, he moves a series of really rich, fat ninth chords. That kind of sound. And when you have rich strings and horns in it, it's a beautiful tone. It's really rich. But, okay, so now we extended the chords really fat. We're moving them parallel, breaking a lot of music theory rules. And then, of course, they employed what I call third-level theory, which is whole tone, symmetrical scales, like whole tone scales. They're symmetrical because, you know, if you notice, the whole step, half step formula isn't. It's like whole, whole, half. It's an asymmetry to it. So the whole tone scale just moves in whole tones. And the interesting thing about this is you get a vague root when you go with complete democracy of all the notes. From Peter Pan, I can fly, I can fly.
Okay.
And then there's a diminished scale. At it's another abstract scale. There's no sense of root where home is. Okay. So they use those, and now we're getting really abstracted. Now tonality, tone, root is becoming more and more vague. Okay.
And who were the composers?
Debussy and Ravel, the important ones. And you have to understand, this is around the time of like Gershwin, okay, too. I mean, these the Impressionists were already into the 20th century.
Okay.
But the let's say the itch began to happen in the late 1800s. Okay.
Okay.
And then finally, okay, so it was like, okay, we've done this. Impressionism lasted a very short period, which tends, when you move from order to chaos, the tendency is when you go through the chaos period, it doesn't last very long.
Because they want to get back to order.
Well, that was my point precisely, is that they want to get back, well, they don't want to get back to order yet, because they haven't gone the whole hog, including the postage. The whole hog, including the postage, became the 12-tone system where now dissonance became a form of harmony, where they accepted dissonance as harmony. So then you get Arnold Schoenberg, some of the experiments...
Ernst Tosch?
Who?
Ernst Tosch from Germany?
I don't know that composer.
Okay. Well, he would fit into that mold.
Yeah, well, all and also, you know, Schoenberg had five very important students that produced, like, Webern and some other guys... producing 12-tone music. Stravinsky experimented with that, but it did not become his MO. He was constantly searching for new things. So he was exploring, well, what can I do? Like, say, for example, the beginning to Rites of Spring. That line is done by an oboe in a register that is like just, it's like me playing the guitar up here, right? It was just like, wow, it's really stretching the tonality of this instrument. But he wanted that. He wanted it to clack a little bit. He wanted the notes to break. I was talking with somebody the other day about this, and actually, when the technology got better and better with instrument building, the oboes were able to play it nice and clean after a point. Like, it sounded just sweet tonality, and they asked Stravinsky about that, and he said, well, yeah, I don't like that. The whole point was to get this kind of quacking sound. So anyway, Stravinsky's had a number of philosophies. Like, one was, if you're going to move from harmony to dissonance, rather than do it in the sense of one chord as dissonant moving to a resolution, let's do an entire section of music, a whole 32 bars that is dissonant, and then as a resolution, we'll do another 32 bars that is more harmonious. So he was thinking in these huge blocks. And he also messed around with time and, you know, what do you call it, poly, I don't know if it's called, I don't think it's called polytonality, but when you play a piece of music and there are two keys playing at the same time. Charles Ives got into this. He split the orchestra into three, and I think he actually had one piece where you use three orchestras and they're playing three different things all at once. All right, so you could hear the chaos in that. You know, if you listen to Charles Ives or you listen to, like, Stravinsky's more abstract pieces or Schoenberg, you'll hear that. But what eventually transpired was, like, the composer, it topped out. It's like, what do we do now? So guys like John Cage are looking into, okay, well, let's do 30, you know, however many minutes of silence it is and copyright that. A lot of guys were messing with microtonality. They topped out with the 12 notes of the Western musical system. All right, so they topped out with the Western musical, they broke every possible rule, and it's like, what do you do now? So, well, let's go to India and see what they're doing, and they mess with microtones. And I remember when I was a kid, I had a avant-garde record of, like, fixed pianos that had two keyboards, and one of the keyboards was tuned, like, just a microtone out of tune with the other keyboard. They composed entire pieces like that. But the problem here is just like that... the wonderful video you sent to me, the Bobby McFerrin, talking about how the pentatonic scale, it made my point. The pentatonic scale is somehow intrinsic. Well, the thing about all this really avant-garde, high-faluting music is that you can't hum the tune. Or you have to be highly trained to do it. I mean, you know, there's an opera Watzek that's by Webern that's right. Like 12 tones, and God, my God, these poor singers have to sing these ridiculous intervals and harmonies. But they have to be trained, really. It's not something that comes natural, right? So the reason I bring this up is the Beatles actually followed a similar course. They went from order to chaos, and then what happened after all of the chaos, the same in the classical music realm, they came back to tonality again because there was nothing else to do. It was like, you know, what else are we going to do, you know? So tonality won, you know, the war. But this seems to be a postmodern phenomenon, like a, you know, late 19th century, 20th century phenomenon. Okay. And I haven't seen it move like that. But the reason I say that is because the Beatles' progression moves from very, you know, their very immediate influences they were trying to sound like, and they were staying within that realm of rules. And then they as they went through their psychological changes, of course, the music changed and so on and so forth, till finally you get something like Revolution 9, which isn't music anymore, right? Which is the top of the chaos, which is the White Album, which was chaotic. And then,
early on, didn't they do other people's songs?
They did that too. Sure.
They were copying people that they liked, evidently.
But. Yeah, the Beatles were unique in that the record companies were shocked when they first came out, because normally when there was a group, they'd have staff songwriters writing for that group, and then along come the Beatles and they write for themselves. This was new. This was unique, and it was surprising and threw them off a little bit. You know
what? Were the Beach Boys doing that at the same time?
Well, that's the cool thing. Yeah, I was thinking about the Beach Boys. They were, like, strong competition for the Beatles, and the Beatles had high regard for them because the Beach Boys, like the Beatles, worked really hard. They really worked hard to make their sound, and so they were one of the bands that kind of stood out in the sense of, we're not just here to grab the brass ring without any background. We have worked really hard to make our sound, and the Beach Boys did a great job.
Now, this may be a stupid question perhaps, but where does, in terms of jazz, as we move through that in the 20th century...
Yeah, it does the same thing.
Bebop? Is bebop more of an exercise in rhythm, or is it more of an exercise in the stuff we've been talking about?
It's a kind of like harmonic jumping through hoops is what bebop is. In other words, they like Giant Steps is the ultimate bebop tune. If you could do Giant Steps in all 12 keys, my God, you're a great jazz musician, right? Well, bebop, you know, had two factors. Fast modulations at the different keys, so you couldn't just play one scale. You had to be aware of every chord as you're moving, and they did it at a really breakneck pace.
Okay.
So it was basically like a theoretical acrobatics that occurred. And this is one thing I complain about jazz. It's totally cerebral. It doesn't reach your heart when it's like that.
Yeah. You know. Was this something, though, where a couple of people sort of set the bar early on, and then everybody... A lot of other serious jazz musicians wanted to emulate that or wanted to see if they could do it. Was it truly more of an exercise than a music from my heart?
Well, I think it was a natural, a very organic thing. I mean, it's that restlessness mm-hmm. that drove the classical composers. Like, we need to do something new. And you see that, like, after bebop, it got so intense, it got so highly cerebral that Miles went through his cool period and said, let's literally cool out. And he wrote really simple, beautiful pieces of music that, you know, you could paint these very kind of zen-like strokes, you know. So that was a reaction. But again, that's kind of like impressionism in a way.
Yeah.
And then you get people like Ornette Coleman and some of these other guys that were experimenting with atonality and, you know, his whole theory of harmonics, which I had that book and it makes no sense whatsoever. So I don't know what the fuck he's talking about, frankly.
Well, now, does that set up that... Is the time period where it sets up that tension between East Coast jazz and the West Coast sound that started coming out? Was the West Coast sound something that kind of was a resolve away from that kind of atonality and that sort of thing?
I don't think it was there for that purpose. I think the jazzers were just moving out here to make money. They heard of the music industry and they parked themselves here. And, you know, when you move from one place to another, I mean, you know, the society you live in, the music reflects it, and so the style changed a bit, you know.
So, but I mean, Brubeck and Getz and Mulligan and all these people that kind of set up shop out here, or were born out. So anyway, we got off track there. I guess your point is that jazz actually kind of followed some of these same ups and downs and tension and release and all that.
Absolutely. It went into its chaos period, you know, or try everything that's possible, including microtonality and all this other stuff. Coltrane, after he had enough of bebop, started going to modes and just doing, like, two-chord modal things, and where you're just playing the same scale or even just a pentatonic scale all the way through. So, yeah, it was this kind of restlessness, exploration thing that was going on. And it seems to have happened in virtually every form of music. Rock was the last to be born, rock and roll, so it took a while before it caught up to that whole kind of pattern. But that happened, too. That eventually occurred.
Was early rock and roll, maybe its accessibility, was brought about by, if you could learn three chords... That's all you needed.
It's like a combination of if you can learn three chords and if you have that youthful, if you're a youth and you're feeling anti-establishment, this is the music for you. You know, which you know, rock and roll has always been the music of anti-establishment.
Right.
You know, rebellion. It's a very natural thing for teens to want to rebel against the authority.
It didn't seem though to require a whole. You didn't have to go to music school for rock and roll.
No, you didn't. But, you know, the guys that had the instinct enough to write chord progressions that were sensible, you know, like an example of that in the extreme would indeed be the Beatles, you know. You know, I mean, you pluck around on guitar, learn the basic chords for guitar. What happens is when you learn chords on the guitar, you're mostly dealing in sharp keys. So there's a limit to the amount of chords you're going to play on a guitar. Therefore, if you compose on a guitar... There's a small universe of chords you can use, and it's kind of easy to write a song once you get to know those chords.
Oh, okay.
You know.
All right.
So, like that. All right, let me check my notes here. All right, so Order to Chaos, back to order. Like, in other words, when you look at the Beatles situation, the height of the chaos happened around the White Album, and it continued to the very depressing Let It Be album. Not many people know that although Let It Be was released last, Abbey Road was actually the last album they recorded.
Okay.
It was released before Let It Be, so they had, you know, that sitting in the coffers. But Abbey Road was their way of saying, the last record was their way of saying, wait, we're the Beatles. We raised the standard of music. Let's make a real Beatles record. Let it be discussed with them, because they were so unhappy with the whole production and everything that happened with it. So they decided, let's end our band. Let's give the world a true Beatles record, and they made Abbey Road.
Okay.
So we go back to order, all right? It's kind of a curve that goes like that. And, you know, it's a slow, long curve to the chaos, and then back down to order.
Like a rather quick
very
dive.
Very quickly, a quick dive.
Yeah.
You know? And that seems to happen over and over again in the arts. Not just in music, but in dance and poetry and all this other stuff, you know? So, because when you make something...